Hello and welcome to another edition of Capital Region Real Estate Today with veteran realtor Anthony Gucciardo. As you know, the real estate market has been as hot as possibly can be. We're going to talk about the ramifications of that, what influences that has on the market, and a host of other things that involve real estate. Anthony, great to see you again.
Great to see you, and thank you for doing this on a 95-degree day today. I know we're out here, it's super hot, and I thank you again for coming and being a part of this little program.
Well, it's always interesting having a chat with you, no matter where it is.
It sure is.
Yep. Summer is in full effect.
Yes.
The market is hot. How's the year going so far?
2021 has been an absolutely fantastic year. The community has been extremely supportive. We have approximately 102 houses set to close by the end of August. We've sold about 50 homes so far this year, valued at about $20 million. The market, July 15th, 2021 will mark my 19th year in the real estate business. And other than 2005, this has been the busiest year I have ever seen in the real estate market, where houses are selling for $10, $20, $50, even $100,000 above list price.
Wow.
Starting to see a slight cool down, though.
Really?
Between graduations, you know, Father's Day weekend, coming into summer vacations, I am starting to see a little decrease in the activity. But overall, 2021 has been a fantastic year to sell a home.
Do you think that little bit of a decrease is just because of the market has sort of run its cycle, the hot market has run its cycle, or is it the graduation, Father's Day stuff that is affecting people's lives?
As of now, I'm hoping that people are starting to, you know, recover from being cooped up in COVID, and I'm hoping that it's just people being busy and schedules being busy. But we did see a peak in the market that we've never seen before. And as with anything, what goes up generally does come down. So I would expect it to cool off a little. However, I still am seeing between 3 to 15 showings per property, depending on where the house is located, on where how you price it, and the type of house you're offering. Certain houses, like houses with in-ground pools, finished basements, seem to be more popular than, say, a three-bedroom ranch on the main road. So it all depends on what you're selling.
Interest rates still are historically low. Have you seen any wiggle room in that, or are they really just holding steady?
Holding steady. They're generally under 3%. I have a lot of people who are getting 30-year mortgages for less than 3%.
Wow.
And, you know, you're seeing 5, 10, 15, 20% down. People are putting sizable down payments down. So I expect that the Fed will keep the rates where they are, which will continue to keep stability in the economy and not have, like, a sudden cool off in the market. So rates have definitely been helping the real estate market.
And this has really had a profound effect on your business, is really keeping it going?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, people who are looking to buy an expensive home, a 3% rate versus a 5% or a 6% rate that we saw years ago is so much better, and it allows a buyer to afford a lot more. So why would you pay, you know, $2,500 or $3,000 a month for rent, which many people still do,
right,
when you could go buy a home and own it, build equity, make the changes you want, and be less than a rental payment?
Are you seeing people, you mentioned, building equity and people still renting, are you seeing people who are basically tired of owning a home, figure this is a good time to get their cash out of the house and move into a rental property?
I have had several people, doctors, lawyers, dentists, who were going to retire in 2 or 3 years, but said, you know what, especially Niskayuna.
Yeah.
Niskayuna is one of my favorite areas. Sometimes in Niskayuna, above 500, above 550 is a little sluggish. It's hard to sell in that price range. This year, everything I've listed in Niskayuna between 550 and 700,000 has sold. So if someone was a year or two out from retiring and they thought that they could get $100,000 more for their house, it was worth it to them to sell, go into a temporary rental until they retire, and pocket that profit that would not be guaranteed had they sold the house in 2 years when they officially retired. And I advise several people this year that this market may not last.
Right.
I don't think it's gonna drop considerably, and I think prices will remain stable. But if you're you know, someone who wants to get $100,000 more than your house is worth, this was the market to do it in.
Yeah, I would imagine.
We saw that time and time again on a lot of properties.
There have been so many stories about people getting so
much more.
Tons of
stories. Oh. I have so many stories that would take a two-hour show to tell you about all the people who have received multiple offers on their home and people who have gotten $50,000 and $100,000 more than their home is worth.
Now, you mentioned people getting multiple offers. Pardon me, there's a little bug flying around. How do you handle buyers who are unhappy with their offer if it's not accepted? In this type of a market, do they really get a second chance?
Well, this is what's happened, Jack, is, you know, sellers sometimes want as much as possible, and buyers think that sometimes they can negotiate, not realizing that an offer may come in that the sellers may know, or there may be a handwritten letter mm-hmm. that the sellers like. And if your offer is $10,000 below list price and someone came in $25,000 above list, even if you come back and go $35,000 or $40,000 above list, you may have given the seller kind of a bad impression. So they want to stick with that someone, that buyer who put the effort forth the first time,
right.
made a strong offer. I've had people show up at my house, my office, pleading with me that their wife or their husband or whoever wants this house. And I've tried to be very delicate because I know buying a house can be emotional. But if a house is listed for $550,000 and it's on the market one day and you come in at $540,000 and someone comes in at $565,000 and then you realize that you're not going to get it and you increase your offer to $585,000, the seller may just stick with that initial offer that mm-hmm. came in that was much greater than what you originally offered. Just because of principle. Some people want to go with the offer that was the strongest from the get-go rather than someone who was trying to get it for less.
The perception almost being it's a more sincere offer
exactly,
and a more sure
exactly.
offer.
Exactly. So if you see a house and you love it, I encourage you to put forth minimum of list price. And if there's multiple offers, which your agent or myself or someone in my company will tell you that there are, then you have the chance to go above. And you can sweeten the deal with large deposits, waiving appraisal contingencies, waiving home inspections. This is a market where it's not that cash is king, it's what's the easiest deal and what's going to net the sellers the most amount of money in the least amount of time, or the time frame that works for the sellers. That's what you have to remember as a buyer.
Okay. You mentioned the numbers of the numbers that you've been dealing with this year, the yes. activity that you've had.
Insanely busy.
All right, somebody looks at this program and says, geez, I'd like to hire Anthony Gucciardo, but he's so darn busy, he's never going to be able to give me the attention that I really require.
That is something that I do hear occasionally, but I think anyone that has worked with me, and at 19 years in this industry, I'm on a referral basis. I do a lot of advertising because it's consistent branding, but I think anyone out there, if you see my sign on a lawn, and you speak with that seller, there's a good chance that they're going to tell you I respond very quickly. I've advertised it before. I answer my phone as frequently as possible when I'm not with clients. And I have a passion for this. I've been doing it 19 years. I still wake up every day and can't wait to work. And I think that's what sets me aside from the competition. I do have a lot of clients, but in order to make a successful career and to pay the bills and to live a decent life, you do have to have multiple clients. And mm-hmm. there are systems that I have in place, cell phones, iPads, laptops that allow me to service my clients pretty much 24/7. I'm not saying I answer my phone at 2 in the morning, but someone who texts me at 9 or 10 a.m. is going to get a call or a text, if not instantaneously, by noontime at the latest, because I pride myself on communication, and I think that is what sets me apart from my competition.
Why your firm rather than a national brand?
Well, I worked for a national brand when I started. I was originally a Coldwell Banker agent, and the brand, the large companies have a phenomenal brand presence. Coldwell Banker, Howard Hanna, Keller Williams, they all are real estate firms, and people know that. And what they occasionally do is they attract the new people in the business, the new agents who see that the market's hot, they want to make a quick buck, and they go and work for these national brands. Mm-hmm. After working for a national brand, and I was one of the top RE/MAX agents for almost 12 years, I realized that other than that name that they provided me, I was the one who was marketing the property, writing the descriptions, making sure the photos were in the right order, making sure the photos were clear, making sure the right agents in the marketplace knew about the property, mm-hmm. making sure the house was clean. The company itself did nothing. But what happens is when you don't have a lot of experience and you don't have 2,900 sales under your belt like I do, you will rely on a national brand to say, well, I work for the largest real estate company in the country. We sold 1 million homes last year. But reality is that agent that you're working with, although they may be affiliated and associated with a national brand, they may have very, very little experience. And when you're hiring someone for what is probably your biggest investment, you want someone with a proven track record. And I think my track record speaks for itself.
And you have people who work with you and for you. Is that?
I do.
Is
and
that...
I only hire people who do not need their hand held, because I believe in this business, you have to act on your feet and you have to be ready to get things done quickly. So I don't hire new agents. I hire agents from brokerages where they have worked for a few years and now they want to go out there and really do it. And that's who I attract at my firm.
So those national firms are really almost your feeder pool.
They're your feeder pool there. I mean, they listen, you know, you're hear the plane in the background, you know that's Southwest Airlines, that's branding. There are brands that people attract to.
Right.
But what people don't realize is a lot of that experience comes from the person you're actually dealing with, the realtor you're actually dealing with. So in my opinion, the name of a company means very little than the actual quality of the agent that you're working with.
How long do you see this market lasting, this aggressive market?
This market is amazing. I mean, it's amazing for sellers. It's amazing for realtors. Not so great for buyers. But if a buyer's going to stay in a house for 10 or 20 years, they probably don't have to worry about values. I think things will cool down. We are still not near the peak in terms of matching other areas in the country, California, Boston, Westchester, you know, parts of Washington, D.C. So I think there's room for growth here. There's a lot of stuff going on, from Regeneron over in Rensselaer County to the Chip Park in Saratoga County. You know, GE starting to hire again in Niskayuna. So I think this area still has growth potential. At 40 years old, I don't plan on retiring anytime soon. I can see myself going for another 10 or 15 years at the pace I'm going before perhaps I turn the reins over to my son or daughter, whoever, if I have children, whatever. But I definitely think this area will continue to grow. This market will cool off and prices will come down a little, but you'll still be able to sell a house in a reasonable amount of time.
And you see the economic development that's going around
Correct.
Here as something that will be sustained.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, everyone I talk with is very positive on the Capital Region. You know, we have a lot of naysayers who don't like our politicians, who don't like our weather, who don't like our taxes. New York is here to stay. We're not going anywhere. A lot of people have flocked to Florida. I know I personally bought a home in Florida myself. I think a lot of people are moving out of the area, but we continue to attract a lot of people because of the affordability, the education, the change of seasons, the cultural diversity that we have. Right. There's a lot of things going here in New York that are great.
It's an interesting place.
It certainly is.
What's your advice to people who are just not ready to sell, but they really want a good buck for their house?
Well, depending on where you're going, if you have a winter home, if you have a lot of people have homes in the Adirondacks, they are probably the best candidate to sell in this market because they don't have to buy in this market. Mm-hmm. If you're making an extra $100,000 on your house, but you got to go buy, and other parts of the country are very busy. So it's an even trade-off almost.
Yeah,
because yeah, you're
a
making
swap.
100 grand, yeah. But now you're going to go to Florida and have to pay 150 above list because there's 25 offers in Miami-Dade or Broward or Pinellas or Collier, or wherever county you're going to in Florida or the Carolinas. It's hot all over. So the people who are benefiting from this the most are people who purchased years ago. And if you're purchasing now and you're going to be here for 20 years, you don't have to worry because cyclically speaking, the market will continue to rise.
In this market, homes have been obviously selling at record prices, as we have discussed. What do you say to a seller who wants to start even higher than what you feel the market should command? I would imagine you get a lot of this. All
I
right,
do.
My half
I
a
do.
Million. Well, let's try 600,000.
I do, and I've had a few sellers, and this is even sometimes my advice, is you see a house that sold for 600, and now your clients have a gorgeous $150,000 backyard and a pool. So you raise it 75,000, and then when you don't get the activity, you have to bring it down. So I'm okay. I am understanding to sellers wanting to start higher in this market, But I think you really need to listen to the advice of your real estate professional. Mm-hmm. Make sure that you are not pricing yourself so high that you're not having activity. And if you do start on the high side, there's nothing wrong with adjusting your pricing coming down.
That doesn't shoot, you don't shoot yourself in the foot doing that.
No, I do not think so, because people will see value and make an offer. And there's only so much inventory out there. So even if you lower the price 50 or 100,000, it's gonna grab someone's attention. And then you get an offer from there.
How important are comparables in a neighborhood for setting a price?
Well, I'll tell you, I had a recent situation in Latham. I had a gorgeous raised ranch here in the Riviera Estates, where I live close to. We listed the house for $445,000, and it sold for $480,000. Now, this was a record for the area, and it was technically a contemporary raised ranch. The house did not appraise, but the buyer and seller basically met in the middle. So we are seeing some appraisal issues, but for the most part in this market, houses are appraising for right about list price.
Now, you said the house did not appraise. What do you mean by that?
What I mean by that is the bank did not agree with the contract sale price, meaning the bank thinks it's worth a certain amount.
Right.
The seller and the realtor and the buyer all agreed to this price, and the bank is saying, no, it's only worth this. Some banks, depending on your loan, will either require you to put more down. And if it's contingent upon an appraisal, then obviously you have a hiccup there in the transaction that you have to work out. I've never in my 19 years seen a deal really fall apart over an appraisal. There's usually a compromise and a negotiation where buyer and seller give. And in some cases, I just had an offer come in tonight in Timberwick, Clifton Park, $25,000 above list. And the first thing the buyers wrote in the contract is that if the house didn't appraise, they agreed to put the difference down because they want the house that badly. Hmm. Some buyers will take it. Other buyers are like, you know what? We'll go find another house. It all depends on how bad somebody wants the house, and it depends on how bad the seller wants to sell. We're facilitators, so we try and piece it together.
Yeah. A couple of months back, the last time we recorded the program, we were inside. There were still a lot of COVID concerns around. We made sure we were 6 feet apart.
Of course.
We're both vaccinated, really worried about it. A lot of restrictions lifted. Do you still have folks who are concerned about having strangers walk through their house for an open house?
Absolutely.
What do you tell them?
What we're doing right now is we're still not doing open houses because the market is busy enough where we don't have to do open houses and we have private appointments. So. Mm-hmm. I'm still providing shoe booties, having people take their shoes off. We are providing sanitizer, of course, and just asking people not to be inconsiderate and use a seller's bathroom. I mean, this is their home, obviously.
Yeah.
You know, you should use the restroom before you go look at property. But I haven't really had anyone tell me they don't want anyone in their house. I just have sellers asking me to be extra careful, have people maybe wear masks if there's anyone in the house who has a compromised immune system. So obviously we respect everyone's wishes and making sure that everyone is safe.
Good, okay. In a strong market like we're in, does the seller have to do basically the same stuff to prepare for the sale or is it a little bit less tedious?
Great question. It's always important that curb appeal is maintained to the highest standard so that when people pull up, they have a good impression. If you live next to, you know, people who don't take so great care of their house, that sometimes can affect what people think when they pull up to your house. But generally speaking, when you are getting your house ready, the buyers are going to make up their mind within about 30 seconds of walking in as to, yes, this will work, or no, this isn't for us.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have to power wash every speck of moss off your roof? No. Do you have to clean every single window in a seller's market like this? No. But generally speaking, the house should be clean, fresh, smell good, and that'll get you the multiple offers that many people are looking for.
Always have the apple pie baked before
Correct.
You open.
I'm still suggesting doing some painting and stuff because, you know, you can spend $5,000 on paint and get $10,000 or $15,000 more.
Yeah.
Plus it shows better, and people aren't thrilled with having to do work when they move in. Although in this market, you see people gutting houses every day.
2008, there was a huge mortgage crisis, mainly because of the balloon mortgages.
Correct.
You pay a very low interest rate for 5 years, and then Correct. It just explodes after that. With buyers paying over list price, do you see a repeat of that, even though we don't have the balloon mortgages around?
Well, what happened in 2006, 7, and 8 is you had buyer Beck and Riley. They were looking at houses in the city of Albany for $180,000, and Beck and Riley really could only afford 140, mm-hmm. but they got approved for 180 or 190, and then they lost their job or the interest rates went up, their loan changed, and Beck and Riley ended up losing their house in foreclosure because one of them lost the job or whatever happened with the mortgage. In 2021, what we're seeing now are the same buyers are receiving a much less interest rate, and the qualifications are different for the loan. So Beck and Riley will come along again, or Joe and Mary come along, and they decide to buy a house that they are financially approved for on paper, and they also can afford it in everyday life, meaning that the bank approves them for $250,000, and they both make $75,000 a year, and they qualify for that loan, plus they're locked into that 3% interest rate or 2.75% interest rate. So we're not seeing the repeat of 2008 because there's no predatory lending. People are being approved for what they really can afford, and not let's give everyone a house. It's they're going through a process now. The loans, the banks, the mortgages are making sure that those people can afford those properties.
It's a much more sane system.
Sane system, and you know, we don't want history to repeat itself. So I don't think you're going to see the issues that you saw in 2008.
That's very good. See your signs everywhere. What do you say to someone who thinks you're just too busy to help them?
I think I answered that before.
Yeah.
Is it on there again?
Yes, sorry. It is. All right.
I have plenty of time to help all my clients. So if you answer the phone or if you call me, you'll see that I answer my phone and get back to you very quickly.
What is the process from the time a seller lists their house with you? What are the steps that happen?
So what happens, Jack, is people watch this show or they see my signs or they, you know, billboards, referrals, whatever the case may be. Generally speaking, as I go out to a client's house, I introduce myself, look around their property, give them suggestions, see if we're a good personality fit, because I think it's important that you hire someone that you not only respect, but you can work well with for 6 months. And that's important. So once I introduce myself, I go over marketing. At that point, if they decided they would want to hire me, many people hire me on the spot. Some people take a few days, some people take a few weeks. I don't pressure anyone. I always tell people I'm not coming here to take pictures. I'm coming here to strictly introduce myself, say hello, and then you make a decision. And after that, the photographer goes out, gets the pictures, and then we officially list the house once I get the seller's approval that the listing conforms to their liking and standards.
And when you actually have a deal to list a property, what are the terms for that? Is it usually a 6 month commitment?
Or? Generally a 3 to 6 month commitment.
So there is some variability with
that. There is some variability, there is some negotiation. I mean, in this market, things are selling very quickly. I had a broker in Niskayuna, she tried to lock clients in for 2 years, and I told the sellers, I said, listen, I can give you 3 months. The house sold in 2 days. So I'm not looking to lock anybody in, because if we're not a good match, we're going to part ways. Mm-hmm. We're going to be respectful. We're going to shake hands and wish each other well. 98% of the time, I can sell a client's property, and we go to the closing, and everyone's happy. So that's the important thing. I've always said, Jack, in the 19 years I've been doing this, if I work with people who are in a good frame of mind and they're happy in life, we're rarely ever going to have an issue. Right. But when you get into those tumultuous situations where people are unhappy with maybe where they are in life or their job or a divorce, they're not going to be happy when the realtor's getting a 6% commission. And I found that I try and work with the happiest people because it makes my job more enjoyable. And I want to work with someone who wants to work with me. I don't want to work with someone who is anti-realtor or anti-salesperson. Yeah. So it's important to work with like-minded people. It really is.
I would imagine so, and it certainly makes your life a lot easier.
Absolutely. Yeah.
As a real estate professional, do you think it's a good time for a first-time buyer to actually get into a home now, or should you wait until the market cools a little bit and maybe the prices go down?
I would probably say, you know, it all depends on where you are in your life, how old you are, what you're looking to do. If you're buying in this market, you're going to pay a premium. Mm-hmm. And if you're thinking you might not stay in this area for a year or two, if the market cools off, you could lose. So to that scenario, I would say don't buy a house. But if you're going to be here for 10 or 15 years and you're raising a family and you're going to be in your starter house for 5 to 10 or 15 years, depending on how long you stay, I think it's okay to buy. Hook up with the right agent and make sure they're not making you pay too much. If the house is $199, you don't want to pay $279.
Yeah.
But if you have to pay $220 or $230, the market will appreciate and catch up, and you'll be okay. And you want to make sure you don't over-improve. That's the key. You don't put a $80,000 in-ground pool in a $200,000 house and expect to get $375 back. You have to be financially smart with the decisions you make. And even after the transaction, I welcome my clients to call me and say, hey, should we put $30,000 in our basement? Should we, you know, should we do a second floor deck? So I'm always happy to give clients advice.
Okay, that sounds good. But speaking of adding on or decks and so on and so forth, several builders have had to cancel contracts just because of the cost of building materials. I imagine that's having an effect on just the availability of inventory. Yeah. Are they stopping building for the time being?
We have some great builders in the area, and I know I work with Marini and Ted Sillis Jr., and they're phenomenal builders. But from what I'm hearing on the street is that builders have not been able to honor those contracts because the lumber prices have soared. So if you're thinking of building a home, again, I think it goes back to how long will you be there? How long are you going to stay in the house? If you're here for 10 or 15 years, the house will appreciate. It will go up. I don't see us heading towards a recession or anything that's going to drop the market that bad. So, you know, I don't think this is a market where you can negotiate with builders because they have no room. They have no room to negotiate. There's not, you know, the lumber prices have reached a new level. They've started to come down a little, but I don't think that the little drop will have a big enough impact where it's going to flood the new construction market. I think it's got to come down a little more, and then I'll think you'll see an uptick in building again.
And do you think it will? Do you think the sawmills and the lumberjacks will catch up to the demand?
I think eventually, I'm hoping they will. You know, people are always going to want to build homes because they want to customize it to their liking. Mm-hmm. There's nothing like a new home smell. I think it's great. I mean, I sell primarily resale, but the new construction homes are great. However, they come higher taxes, obviously, because your assessment's fresher and newer. And resale, new construction, it all depends on where you are in your life, what you want to do, and the builder you choose to go with. Because, you know, you look at like Marini-built homes. Every Marini-built home I have sold in my 19-year career, those sellers have made a substantial profit. So it was a good investment for that buyer.
In the fall, winter, and spring, it's always good to have a nice warm house when you show.
Correct.
This time of year, Is it good to have a hot house?
It is. You know, it's not good to have a hot house. I'll tell you. I mean, I have people leave and they want the house to be 90 degrees because they don't put the air conditioner on. I advise you to keep things comfortable, whether it be in the winter. The house should not be 55 degrees. It should be 68, 70, 72. And in the summer, if it's 95 degrees out like it is today, your house should be 72. If you don't have central air, obviously that's, you know, something you have to deal with. But a cooler house and a warmer house in line with feeling comfortable is a much better presentation than walking into a house where you want to run out because it's so hot or run back to your car because it's so cold and you want to get in the heat. So,
20 seconds. Any last thoughts?
I want to thank the community for your continued support. 2021 has been an outstanding year. We're through the mess of COVID and all the other messes that came with 2020. And I am sincerely thankful for all of your support. And Jack, it is a scorcher out here. Thank you so much for doing this show. Wow. And Capital Region, we are ready. If you want to sell your home or buy your home, please give me a call. I'd love to help you.
All right. That's another edition of Capital Region Real Estate Today. I'm Jack Arnicke with Anthony Gucciardo. Thank you very much for viewing, and have yourself a wonderful day.